You ever go about your own business, vibing, living life, then something happens. You see something, read something, overhear something, and somewhere in the back of your head, you think to yourself, wow, just what are the odds? Whether it's that baby making a perfect bottle flip, miraculously escaping death, or effing up in such a way that it leaves fellow people around pondering you, how the pluck did you do that? Well, before I begin, let me guys tell you that this is going to be the first of many Storytime speed draws. And right now in the background, anytime I'm going to be showing a speed draw that is showing off my characters or my story, whether it's story building, world building, that it is time to buckle up and settle in for a Storytime speed draw. And for this video, it is going to be my personal little what are the odds story. And if you don't know, in the background, I am drawing Suzume. She's one of my main characters for my story, The Truth. That said, this is my own personal what are the odds story. And trust me, I wish I hadn't enacted such a cruel fate upon the person involved due to my people-pleasing folly. But alas, here we are. Allow me to regale you the tale of my very own what are the odds story that has cemented into my mind since childhood. This takes place when I was back in middle school, or secondary school for those of you that are not in the States, although I'm not too sure. Someone from the outside of the States may need to fact check me on that. And I was maybe in sixth or seventh grade at the time. I was roughly 12, give or take. And oh boy, wouldn't you know, during that lovely pubescent transition of my life, I was also given braces! Oh, yay, the joys. Yep, my teeth, like some of you, were coming in crooked, and I needed to get the good old metal claptrap to fix my face. More about that later. It was summer vacation, perhaps near the end of June, and I was delighted to be invited by an old friend of mine to go to the town fair. Ah, yes, the fair. Going to just experience G-Force intensive rides the one time out of the year felt like an amazing midsummer holiday as a child. So, of course, I had no qualms going with my friend. Her father was kind enough to pay for lunch for us beforehand, and I unfortunately needed to mind my food. Those braces I was talking about? Well, actually, I had the precursor crypt, which are called spacers. As such, the dentist recommended a more soft food diet and liquids, and sadly for the life of me, I can't remember if I did or did not have any actual food. What I do remember having, though, was a triple berry blast from a place called Orange Julius. Such a delicious concoction of an assortment of fruits that created its purple hue. This smoothie felt like that perfect medium for my poor, spacer-ridden mouth. Now, with lunch promptly devoured, the time for the fair was among us! We got our papery self-adhesive wristbands attached, which honestly felt like adult and child-proof for removal because half the time you needed scissors to even take the damn thing off at the end. But we were off. Sights, sounds, carnival-smelling foods. For me, entering the fair became an equivalent if I were given admission to head into my very own roller coaster tycoon. Now, growing up, my family and I specifically went on rides and avoided any carnival games. And I think my parents did that because buying the wristbands to go on the rides were expensive enough. But to also pay for one round of a game that may or may not be rigged for an overpriced, large stuffed toy that you most likely could purchase online. Yeah, no. Carny games just weren't in the budget, especially when almost all of them would do cash only. Granted, this was back in the day before ePay really took off. But that routine of things had stuck with me, so even when I went with my friend, I just had one thing on my mind. Rides. I was a growing child. I need these machines to yeet my senses around so that way I can learn proper balance into my adulthood. I don't remember the first rides we decided to do, but I remember at least three leading up to the events of my demise. Ugh, so sad. The first ride I called the Pharaoh, appropriately named because it was Egyptian themed, had a golden pharaoh's mask on the ends of this swinging boat-like contraption. Very tame, basically a big swing. And if you wanted to be put more off balance instead of sitting in the middle, you would try to go and sit at the back against the pharaoh's head. We hop on, enjoying the giant version equivalent to a swing you could find at a park, and then hopped off where her father's chauffeur waited. Next, my friend wanted to go on the Gravitron. It basically looked like a UFO decorated in fun, colorful light bulbs where you could go inside and it would spin so fast that your body would become compressed to the movable sides that go up, then down. A little more scaled up than the Pharaoh, but by the time I stepped off that ride and began to wander around, I started to feel the J's. I took a moment to take a seat to get my bearings, trying to breathe deeply because even my pubescent butt knew I wasn't okay. Thankfully, I'm given that reprieve, but for a short while. My friend wanted another ride, and soon. They were a tad impatient, and I was a people pleaser. This is obviously not a good combination when the people pleaser of the group isn't feeling well, but alas, I stood up from where I sat and I decided to follow where my friend wanted to go next. This ride would end up being the boss battle I ultimately decided to rage quit and never return, but with less rage and more ick. The next ride my friend half begged me to go on was this circular, gangly armed ride. The arms strapped with a pod that paired two at the ends that spun individually while the monstrous black behemoth spun itself, added with the motion of going up and down like a wave while we went round and round. I called this ride the octopus. Some of you may also refer to it as the spider. But for the duration of this story time, I'ma continue to call this ride the octopus. We stepped in line, and while we waited, I began to feel a little better, a little hopeful, a little optimistic. I felt like whatever had come over me had thankfully come to pass. We eventually step up to the front. The ride associates got us locked in our seats, and the arm of the octopus hoists us up to where our pod rocked back and forth. To and fro, and that feeling I oh so foolishly believed was gone began to stir. With every shift of movement, I leaned back and closed my eyes, praying that I could, that I would, somehow overcome this returning bout of nausea. I tried focusing on anything, tuning into sounds, taking more deep breaths, steeling my nerves for the ride that was soon to happen while the attendants shuffled more unaware children and young adults onto their spinning black behemoth of doom. And then the ride started. The spinning of the octopus, the spinning of the pods, the rise and the fall of its arms, and the chaos. After feeling like I leaned forward and back, trying to brace myself from the overwhelming force, it had won. I lurched forward, but my people-pleasing self refused. What if you puke on someone in the crowd? Someone in line? Your friend right next to you? That would be so rude! A hand clapped over my mouth and a spurt sprayed into my palm, but I willed myself not to eject the whole load. A plan! I needed a plan, guys! Overcome with social anxiety, the purple concoction uncomfortably brewing in my gut, within a ride that still had 10 hellish minutes or so to go, I had to think fast. I started to look for a place to unleash. My head whipped around, searching. Even among the spins, I could steal glimpses of the area. Like in that moment, I had become a ballerina and learned how to spot when we spun around. Then I found it. The back of the rides had cords that would run down and be hooked up to stationed generators. These were the areas that resembled self-made alleys to help deter the public from crossing, and most likely due to safety reasons when you had cords as thick as my wrist running along the ground. I had found my target, the pavement of the desolate alley behind my eight-armed captor. Perfect. Now, I needed to time my delivery. First orbit, check. Second orbit, I'm ready. Third, I lunged my upper half forward and was given the sweet release of freedom. However, as fate would have it, during my checks, I had noticed something. Something distinct. Movement. During the second check, I realized there was a small boy traveling closer to the ride, donned in a bright yellow shirt, khakis, and some flip-flops. In the third check, I no longer saw him. So now, I frantically began to look, praying, hoping, but alas, when my eyes caught sight of the child, he was running back from whence he came, crying, hair soppy and flat against his head, the yellow on his shoulders, now donning a darker, slightly discolored hue. It was just as I feared. I had chirped my chips onto this random little boy who looked like a kindergartner. Now, the fact that I had somehow projectile vomited directly on top of the boy is crazy enough, but the phone doesn't stop there. Oh no, I had started a whole ass drama. Waiting out the rest of my ride, I watched as the sludge-covered tyke returned to whom I want to believe was his mother. Confusion, at least from what I could tell. Adult heads turning, trying to figure out just how did their boy become this way. Finally, the ride stopped. Eagerly, I hopped off and scampered away, catching a glimpse of some older-looking teenage girls taking her place. They unknowingly climbed in, not realizing some purple backsplash had tainted my seat. A few looks of disgust before the attendant, who probably doesn't get paid enough already, locked them in, and the octopus hoisted them into the air before anything could be said. My deepest apologies, you poor dearies. I glanced around towards the back of the ride, and honestly, I really shouldn't have. Like, checking in on the situation would really do much good, considering I'm the perpetrator here. The next thing I know, I saw who I assumed to be the mother rise to her feet and overheard her bellow, "Who did this?" I had activated Mama Bear mode, which sent chills through me, and I hurried away back to my friend's side with her father, who were wondering where I had gone. Yet, her father took one look at me and caught how unclean my clothes were. Surprisingly, my shirt was mostly clean, but somehow my jeans, especially the cuffs, right above my shoes were well stained by my previous lunch. I didn't want to cut things short, but the dad was kind enough to take me home, let me get changed, and brought me back. The weird part is that I don't know where he put my friend, his daughter. Like, I'm pretty sure she wanted to stay at the fair and didn't want to go home yet. And I don't remember her during the ride home so I could get changed and come back. So I think her dad just sort of peaced out feeling she was fine, took me home, I got changed and came back. Damn. The wild things you could get away with when I was a child, I guess. I'm just glad that I remember meeting back up with her when I came back to the fair. Some time passes. We went to a few stalls and checked out the merchandise. Then, as it started to become late, the dark sky causing the rides to light up in their ceremonious glow indicating night, I went to go on one last ride, which to my friend seemed lame, and they didn't want to go, so we compromised and she went off to go on some other ride close by, and her father supervised both parties from a distance. This ride, I remember it being called the Moby Dick. It had a large splash art of the infamous white whale, and the ride basically was an alternate version of the Pharaoh. Instead of sitting front to back and feeling the G's accordingly, you were strapped in a seat and felt the G's side to side as the ride would swing you around. Nothing crazy, no going upside down in any of these rides, and for me, it felt like the perfect ride to end my hectic night. Or so I thought. A few people down in the line where I stood, I overheard a conversation. The voices were loud enough that it caught my attention, and I couldn't help but listen in, considering I had nothing better to do while I waited. Then I heard the feminine but irritable voice say, "Yeah, somebody puked all over my boy." I froze. I resisted the urge to look behind me, to confirm that these people are the exact same people I had an incident with at the octopus hours earlier. But I refrained. I thought to myself, making eye contact would surely mean certain death, an admission to my crimes. So I remained silent and continued to face forward till I could be let on this last ride of the night. My memory is a bit fuzzy around this point, and I never did check to see if the individuals talking were the same group. I completely ignored the conversation after I heard a puke and boy. Perhaps it was just a coincidence and maybe a completely unrelated family or situation, but to me, it wasn't. I'm sure that in that moment, I felt like I had to keep my eyes forward and stepping out of line would also somehow flag me as the culprit, even though I had a change of clothes by that point. God, could you imagine the child me's brain is sitting there thinking the moment I took one toe out of line, there she is! There's the culprit! That's the person who did it! Who soiled my boy! It's so crazy to think about, but at the same time, that was what younger me just felt like what would happen. So it's like eyes forward, toes straight, say nothing, and just don't even look. But yes, just what are the odds to end up making a direct hit with a triple berry blast, stomach acid rain, and end up being the same line hours later with possibly the same family I had just pissed off. The irony of this situation is that years prior when I was still in grade school, my brother ended up getting spacers and actually upchucked on an apple-themed tilt-a-whirl with my sister, who tried her hardest to inch away from a trail threatening to sled from the seat to her pant leg. And here I am repeating circumstances, but with different variables. Though, yes, what happened to that little boy was terrible, and hopefully he was too little to remember the purple glob that had it out for him. But I feel like those older teenage girls are the ones who really got the short end of the stick. Just imagine being all excited to go on a ride, and you end up sitting in a befoul-smelling, wet, splattered seat. Literally being placed in the excess of someone else's stomach sauce, and forced to endure the duration of the ride. In the summer heat, mind you. If any of that touched skin, just bleh, 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 bleh. I'm so sorry, dear teenage girls of my past. Hopefully this incident you can look back on and laugh, and if not, perhaps taught you a valuable lesson in the importance of sanitation. I honestly should have told the ride attendant, but alas, I don't even think my friend with me at the time realized I irped until her dad pointed out. And if that's the case, then I must have been some kind of ninja during all that spinning. Also, can I just say, why in the world was there a little child wandering the back areas of the rides all and unsupervised? If FNAF has taught me anything, that's a big no-no. Granted, maybe he was being watched, but there certainly was an adult with him at the time of the incident. In the end, perhaps his misfortune was actually a blessing in disguise, and he didn't end up falling on some exposed wires or worse. Well, there you have it. My what are the odds story. Be sure to let me know in the comments below what are your what are the odds story. Something that just made you pause, do a double take, whether it's fortunate or unfortunate, I would love to read them. So, thank you, my peeps, for watching, and I will catch you in the next one. So remember, everybody, be awesome, be you. Akemi, out.